So now let me discuss the complications one by one. Let us start our discussion with a bleeding complication. So bleeding complication, let us start with, okay, that is a most common complication and that is a most common cause of death in duodenal ulcers. So bleeding duodenal ulcer is usually seen from the posteriorly located ulcer. This is the ulcer which is located posteriorly, and this ulcer is exactly sitting on this artery. What is this artery? This artery is gastroduodenal artery. It is exactly sitting on this artery, gastroduodenal artery. If the ulcer is so active, it can go and penetrate the gastroduodenal artery, and the gastroduodenal artery will bleed into the duodenum like this. The bleeding into the duodenum will present to you most commonly with hematemesis. So the bleeding complication is 60% of the time the bleeding ulcer, duodenal ulcer, presents with hematemesis, and 40% of the time it presents with melena. Okay, the presentation can be 60% time it can present with hematemesis and 40% time it can present with melena. This is the presentation of bleeding duodenal ulcer. So these are the presentations of bleeding duodenal ulcer. The patient will present to you the massive hematemesis. It is not a mild hematemesis. Many times they have massive hematemesis. So patient comes to your hospital, immediately you will start IV line, IV fluids started. IV fluids started, number one. Number two, immediately we should give the drug of choice. What is the drug of choice for bleeding duodenal ulcer? Drug of choice is injection proton pump inhibitors. Injection proton pump inhibitors is a drug of choice. We have to immediately start proton pump inhibitors, omeprazole or pantoprazole. Something should be given IV in infusion. It will be going on. Put a Ryle's tube so that the patient will not aspirate the blood and it will decompress the stomach. Ryle's tube aspiration, all these are going on one side. So immediately we will start transfusing, blood transfusion also will be started. So when all these are going, we have to send the patient to the medical gastroenterologist. The patient will be now referred to a medical gastroenterologist for investigation of choice known as upper GI endoscopy. Upper GI scopy is the investigation of choice. We should refer the patient for upper GI scopy. Upper GI scopy, the medical gastroenterologist will do upper GI scopy. And when he is going to do upper GI endoscopy, he will put on classification known as forest classification of bleeding duodenal ulcer. This is a classification for bleeding duodenal ulcers. So forest classification of bleeding duodenal ulcers we are going to use now. So what is this forest classification? Forest classification of bleeding duodenal ulcer is of following types. Type 1, that is an active bleeding ulcer, active bleeding duodenal ulcer seen. Type 1 is active bleeding duodenal ulcer is seen, that is type 1. Active bleeding duodenal ulcer is known as type 1. Type 2 is further divided into A, B, C, which we call it as V, C, D. V for visible vessel, please remember, V for visible vessel. C for visible clot, D for dot. So this is a classification. So at the level of posterior duodenal ulcer area, you can see the visible vessel. That area is having a clot. It is having a black dot. Black dot means the bleeding has completely stopped. Then comes 3. 3 is a healed duodenal ulcer. The ulcer is totally stopped. So 1 is active bleeding duodenal ulcer, 2 A, B, C. 3 is healed duodenal ulcer. This is about the forest classification of bleeding duodenal ulcer. In this classification, I will tell you, 1 and 2A will immediately need endoscopic treatment. Endoscopic therapy is done for 1 and 2A. What is the endoscopic therapy we do? We will inject epinephrine injection around the ulcer. Injection epinephrine is put around the ulcer. Around the ulcer, we will put epinephrine injection, or we can do coagulation of the bleeding vessel. Even sometimes we can do clipping of the bleeding vessel. All these are various endotherapy which is advised for 1 and 2A only, because 1 and 2A have high risk of rebleeding will be there. In 1 and 2A there is high risk of rebleeding present, so I should do endoscopic therapy for 1, 2A. Other cases we can treat them with a conservative management also. So this is forest classification of bleeding duodenal ulcer. Forest classification of bleeding duodenal ulcer. And the most common vessel that is bleeding here is in a duodenal ulcer is gastroduodenal artery, which is also known as artery of hemorrhage. Artery of hemorrhage, which is known as artery of hemorrhage. Gastroduodenal artery is known as artery of hemorrhage. It bleeds like anything. It is going to bleed like anything known as gastroduodenal artery, artery of hemorrhage. So, what is the indication of surgery? When will you call a surgeon to come and deal with this case? Indication of surgery. So, please remember, indication of surgery for these patients. What are the indications of surgery? Number one, more than or equal to 6 units transfused per day on admission day. On the patient getting admitted, more than 6 units of blood transfused on day of admission. Day of admission itself, we have transfused more than 6 units. Number 2, more than or equal to 3 units we need daily. Daily the patient is bleeding and we are doing 3 units daily. Number 3, more than 2 attempts of endoscopy failed. More than 2 attempts of endoscopy. The medical gastroenterologist trying with an endoscopy, you know. More than 2 attempts of endoscopy failed. That is the next indication. More than 2 attempts of endoscopy failed. Patient is hemodynamically unstable patient. So, more than or equal to 6 units transfused on admission, more than 3 units per day transfused, 2 attempts of endoscopy failed, hemodynamically unstable patient, rare blood group of the patients, rare blood groups of the patient. Number 6, patient is involved in some peripheral area, some, for example, a patient who is working in a military area or from a police department, somewhere the patient is from a very far away, the patient may not be accessible the next time. That cases also we will go for a treatment. That is not the most important indication, but please don't forget these 5. So more than 6 units transfused on admission, 3 units daily, 2 attempts of endoscopy failed, hemodynamically unstable patient, rare blood groups. So these are the places where we have to go for surgery. And what is the surgery I will do? So the surgery I will do is I will immediately do laparotomy. I will open the abdomen, laparotomy, and I will open the duodenum. Duodenum first part is opened by horizontal incision known as duodenotomy. So like this, the first part of duodenum is horizontally opened like this. Now I can see the posteriorly located ulcer will be seen like this. This is with ulcer with the gastroduodenal artery is seen. And from the gastroduodenal artery, we are seeing one branch that is superior pancreaticoduodenal artery. This is superior pancreaticoduodenal artery, which will be running behind. So now what I am going to do in duodenotomy, I am going to do duodenotomy and I am going to ligate the vessel above, below, laterally. So 3 sutures I will make. So I will make 3 point U suture is done. 3 point U suture done for the patients. So I am going to make 3 sutures, suturing here and suturing here, 3 point U ligation done for these type of patients, 3 point U suture ligation done. This is done and duodenum closed in unstable patients, that's all. Unstable patients, I will do laparotomy, duodenotomy, 3 point U suture ligation and close. In a stable patient, for a one time treatment, I can go for one more treatment, that is, I will also go for truncal vagotomy along with this. I will also do a truncal vagotomy with the duodenum is opened horizontally. No, I will make that extended to the pylorus and I will close it vertically. That is known as Hinckley-Mikulicz pyloroplasty will be done. So the incision will be extended onto the pylorus like this, and after closing, I will close it like this vertically so that the pylorus will be open always. So Hinckley-Mikulicz pyloroplasty will be done. So the duodenum which is being opened here will be extended to the pylorus and we will close it vertical closure. This procedure is known as Hinckley-Mikulicz pyloroplasty. So please don't forget the management of bleeding duodenal ulcer. So management of bleeding duodenal ulcer, it is usually the bleeding from gastroduodenal artery. The drug of choice is injection proton pump inhibitors. That investigation of choice is upper GI scopy. The patient will undergo FAST classification. In FAST classification, active bleeding ulcer and 2A visible vessel will need, these two cases will need endoscopic therapy. So there are certain indications of surgery. Please don't forget the indication, more than or equal to 6 units transfused, 3 units daily, 2 attempts of endoscopy failed and hemodynamically unstable patients. So now bleeding. This is about the bleeding duodenal ulcer. Coming to bleeding gastric ulcer. So bleeding gastric ulcer is compared to duodenal ulcer is very, very less. Bleeding from the gastric ulcer is very less. So if it is going to bleed, bleeding is going to happen from the gastric ulcer. It usually presents as melina in 60% patients. Only 40% patients have hematemesis. So hematemesis is less common in gastric ulcer. 60% is melina. And the most common vessel which will bleed in a duodenal gastric ulcer is left gastric artery is the vessel of bleeding. Vessel of bleed in a case of gastric ulcer is left gastric artery will bleed. Please don't forget this. So left gastric artery will bleed in a gastric ulcer patients. So left gastric artery will bleed most commonly in these patients. Please don't forget that point. Bleeding gastric ulcer is mostly from left gastric artery. Most important point. And now a bleeding gastric ulcer patient comes to you. You have to see whether the patient is stable or unstable. Many times this question has come in the JIPMER exam. Unstable patients, we will just do laparotomy and oversew the ulcer. That's all. I will open the abdomen, I will open the stomach, and I will go and suture this ulcer like this. In an unstable patient, I will do laparotomy and oversew the ulcer. In a stable patient, if the patient is stable, better I will go for gastrectomy, distal gastrectomy. If the ulcer is distal, I should go for distal gastrectomy will be done for those patients. With Billroth 2 reconstruction will be done. Distal gastrectomy with the Billroth 2 done for stable patients. So bleeding gastric ulcer is relatively a less common complications. But in unstable patients, I should go for laparotomy and oversewing the ulcer. In a stable patient, I should go for distal gastrectomy plus Billroth 2 operation. I should go for a distal gastrectomy plus Billroth 2 operation in a case of bleeding gastric ulcer patients. So this is a very common important point, first important complication, that is about the bleeding. So now let me go on to the next complication, that is perforation peritonitis. Perforation peritonitis, very, very important complication. Enormous discussion points are there in this complication. So perforation peritonitis, let us discuss about duodenal ulcer perforation. That is most common, duodenal ulcer perforation we are going to discuss now. I told you the most common site of duodenal ulcer which goes for perforation is anteriorly located ulcers. They will perforate into the free peritoneal cavity. They will perforate into the free peritoneal cavity and they will have the following clinical features. They perforate into the peritoneal cavity and they will have, initially they will have leakage of the bile. The bile will come out, gastric juice will come out, and initially there will be leaking of bile. So the initial problem is chemical peritonitis features will be there. There will be initially chemical peritonitis which is due to bile. So the patient will have epigastric pain. They come to you with the epigastric pain, and when you go and examine him, he will have guarding and he will have rigidity. Guarding is nothing but a voluntary phenomenon. When you are going to touch the abdomen, he will put his abdomen tight. That is a voluntary phenomenon. Rigidity, it is having a board-like rigidity. It is a board-like rigidity. It is an involuntary phenomenon. It is an involuntary phenomenon. Board-like rigidity, voluntary phenomenon is guarding. So guarding and rigidity are the two classical findings in duodenal ulcer perforation. So voluntary is guarding, rigidity is involuntary finding. So please don't forget, the patients may have guarding and rigidity. And as there is a leakage of gas, you can see from here the gas will leak. That will go and cover around the liver. That will cover the liver. So there will be obliteration of liver dullness. Obliteration of liver dullness seen. So please don't forget, there will be obliteration of liver dullness will be present. Because of the gas over the liver dullness will be obliterated. You cannot palpate the liver dullness or percuss the liver dullness. And slowly the chemical peritonitis becomes bacterial peritonitis. The patient becomes sicker and sicker now more. The patient develops bacterial peritonitis, shock will be present, and patient goes for tachycardia, hypotension, temperature increases. Along with this, the patient will have Hippocratic phases. The phases will be Hippocratic phases seen in these patients. They have Hippocratic phases will be seen in these bacterial peritonitis cases. They will have bacterial peritonitis patients will have shock, pulse rate increase, BP decrease and temperature will be increased in bacterial peritonitis. So now you are suspecting this is a case of duodenal ulcer peritonitis. There is one interesting syndrome which can happen. In that syndrome, what happens? This is abdomen. The bile which is leaking from here, no, they will track and they go to the right iliac fossa here, and they will irritate the right iliac fossa and they cause pain in the right iliac fossa. Instead of having pain in the epigastric region, the bile which will track along the right paracolic gutter will go into the right iliac fossa and cause pain in the right iliac fossa, mimicking like appendicitis. Mimics like appendicitis, and many a times we surgeons open thinking it is an appendix, and appendix will look normal in those cases. Appendix will look normal in those cases, and we will see bile coming out from the paracolic gutter, and this syndrome is known as, what is the name of this syndrome? This is known as Valentino syndrome. Please don't forget, this syndrome is known as Valentino syndrome. So this syndrome is known as Valentino syndrome. The gas will, the bile will be coming out from here and causing irritation of the right hypochondrium, known as right iliac fossa, known as Valentino syndrome. The treatment of Valentino syndrome is laparotomy and perforation closure. Laparotomy plus omental patch closure. That is a treatment of duodenal ulcer perforation, which I am going to deal later. So laparotomy plus omental patch closure. Also we will do appendicectomy to avoid future confusions. Also we will do appendicectomy, though it is normal, we will remove it. To avoid any future confusion, I will also remove the appendix. This is known as Valentino syndrome. Valentino syndrome. So I am suspecting perforation. What is the first done investigation? Can you tell me? The first done investigation in this case of perforation is, immediately I will ask the patient to take X-ray abdomen, erect, including diaphragm. Including the diaphragm, I need the X-ray. Including the diaphragm, I should take an X-ray abdomen erect. In an erect X-ray, even 1 mL of air, 1 mL of air in the peritoneum can be detected. That is known as pneumoperitoneum. Pneumoperitoneum can be detected in an X-ray abdomen erect. This is an X-ray erect abdomen. You can see gas under the diaphragm or air under the diaphragm here. It is seen in 78% of the patients have pneumoperitoneum is present. In perforation patients, 70% of them will have air under diaphragm, known as pneumoperitoneum. This is known as air under diaphragm. In 70% of the patients, we have air under diaphragm seen. In 70% of them, we will have air under diaphragm seen. Don't forget this point. If the patient is telling, sir, I am unable to stand erect, I am very having so much of pain, I am unable to stand erect, we will take a X-ray left lateral view. Please remember, we will take an X-ray left lateral view in such cases. I will take an X-ray left lateral view in such patients. In an X-ray left lateral view, I will see where I will see the gas. In the X-ray left lateral view like this, if the patient is lying like this, X-ray left lateral view, I will see the gas in the upper part of the right hypochondrial area. In the right hypochondrium, in the upper part, I will see the gas like this. To diagnose gas here, at least 5 to 10 ml air minimum needed. In an erect X-ray, I can diagnose 1 ml air. But here I need 5 to 10 ml air. 5 to 10 ml air. What are the other findings in X-ray abdomen erect? So please remember, what are the other findings we can get in X-ray abdomen erect? In an X-ray erect abdomen, I can see so many findings. What is the name of this sign? The air is seen on either side of the Ziffy sternum like a mushtaq. The Ziffy sternum area, air is seen like this, like a mushtaq. This sign is known as cupola sign. Cupola sign. Presence of huge amount of gas in the abdomen like this, looking like an American football. It is known as football sign. It is known as football sign. It is known as football sign. And one more sign in which the bowel gas is seen, both inside the bowel also we have gas, outside the bowel also we have gas. This is known as double wall sign. What is the name of this? Double wall sign, known as Riegler's sign. So please don't forget, cupola sign, Riegler's sign, football sign, all are seen in perforation peritonitis. And in the posterior perforations, if this is a kidney, in posterior perforations, we can have air around the kidney like this. So So air around the kidney will be seen. This is known as renal veil sign. Renal veil sign. Renal veil or halo sign. Presence of perinephric gas is also seen in some perforations. Is also seen in some posterior perforations of duodenal ulcer. Sometimes the air can go in the retroperitoneum and we can have gas in the retroperitoneal area, known as renal veil or halo sign. And all these are findings seen in a perforation peritonitis. Finally, Chiliaditi's syndrome. What is this Chiliaditi's syndrome or Chiliaditi's sign? What is this Chiliaditi's sign in an X-ray? I am taking an X-ray. In an X-ray, I am seeing this is the liver, and above the liver, I am seeing gas like this. I am seeing gas above the liver like this. But it is not a case of perforation. It is actually a colon getting interpositioned. It is a colon getting in between the liver and diaphragm. The presence of colonic gas, this is known as colonic gas, colon gas interposition, colon gas interposition is known as Chiliaditi's sign. So please don't forget, presence of colon gas is known as interposition in between the liver and the diaphragm is known as Chiliaditi's sign. It is nothing to worry, no need to worry about Chiliaditi's sign. It is a normal finding, presence of gas. It mimics like air under diaphragm, that is the problem. It mimics like air under diaphragm in X-ray. These are all typical VIVA questions for final years. So it mimics like air under diaphragm. The VIVA examiners will ask you, can you tell me, doctor, which place you get air under diaphragm, but it is not a perforation? Answer is colonic interposition of gas. That is a classical VIVA question asked in the exams. So now we have confirmed with the X-ray itself in 70% cases. If you have a doubt, what is the investigation of choice? If you have a doubt of perforation, investigation of choice is what? Or the gold standard investigation is to take CT abdomen. CT abdomen is the investigation of choice. If you want, you can use oral gastrographin to drink. But you should not use barium contrast. So barium is contraindicated in intestinal perforations because it will cause barium peritonitis. Very, very important point. Barium investigation is contraindicated if you suspect duodenal ulcer perforation because it can cause barium peritonitis. It can cause barium peritonitis. It is absolutely contraindicated in GIT perforation. But you all know very well, barium is the contrast of choice for esophageal perforation because in the esophageal perforation, it is relatively inert in the chest. It will not cause mediastinitis, much common. Whereas in the peritoneum, it is causing peritonitis. Esophageal perforation, this is the contrast of choice. But for intestinal or GI perforation inside the peritoneum, it should not be used. In fact, if you are going to use it, you are into medical legal issues. You will get into medical legal trouble. Don't use it. Okay. So the gold standard investigation is CT abdomen. When you want, you can give oral gastrographin contrast. That is 100% sensitive investigation. 100% sensitive investigation. So now I have confirmed duodenal ulcer perforation. The treatment is immediately I will put a Ryle's tube. IV fluid resuscitation will be started. IV fluids, Ryle's tube aspiration, high level antibiotics, higher antibiotics are started, and we should not delay. We should immediately shift the patient to the theater for emergency laparotomy. There is no role of wait and watch. We have to immediately shift for emergency laparotomy at the earliest possible. Shift the patient to theater and open the abdomen and give complete lavage. Complete lavage means wash. I still remember I have used around 25 normal saline to wash the entire peritoneal cavity. Lavage the peritoneal cavity. Complete lavage of the peritoneal cavity is very important step I should do now. Completely wash the peritoneal cavity, and after washing it, I have to now look for the perforation. It will be usually seen on the first part of the duodenum. So if the ulcer size is less than 1 cm, I can directly do closure with Vicryl. So very small ulcers less than 1 cm means I will directly close with the Vicryl. 1 to 3 cm cases, I will use a omentum. This is a omentum here, no? I will use a omental flap like this. Live omental patch is kept on this, and I will fix with the omentum. I will fix the omentum with the Vicryl. So 1 to 3 I will use modified Graham's omental flap is used. Omental flap closure is used. Closure is used for 1 to 3 cm. Those ulcers in the duodenum more than 3 cm or in the stomach more than 3 cm, we call it as giant ulcers. Giant ulcers are more than 3 cm. They have the risk of developing a fistula is there. Risk of developing EC fistula, enterocutaneous fistula, is present in these patients. Giant ulcers has a risk of developing a enterocutaneous fistula. So I should be very careful in managing these patients with more than 3 cm. So what I am going to do for this patient, therefore, I am going to do the following procedures. With such a huge ulcers, what I am going to do is, I will close this pylorus. I will close this pylorus. Please remember, I will close this pylorus. I will close the pylorus. And I will do a gastrojejunostomy like this. Gastrojejunostomy like this, so that the food particles will move in this direction. And I will bring a jejunum. This is a jejunum going on further, no? I will bring some part of jejunum and I will approximate it like this, very nearby like this. So I will approximate this and I will close this hole with a jejunal serosal patch. So this is known as jejunal serosal patch closure. Jejunal serosal patch closure plus pyloric exclusion plus GJ is a treatment of choice for this type of huge ulcers to prevent EC fistula. This is done to prevent enterocutaneous fistulas. This is done to prevent enterocutaneous fistulas. Please don't forget this point. This is all done to prevent the enterocutaneous fistulas which may happen from the hole. So less than 1 cm ulcer, directly I can close. Directly I can close. 1 to 3 cm, I will use the modified Graham's patch closure. More than 3 cm, I will go for a jejunal serosal patch closure with a pyloric exclusion, and gastrojejunostomy will be done for perforated duodenal ulcers. This is the management of perforated duodenal ulcers. In sometimes, if the omentum is not available because of fat necrosis, if omentum not available, I will use another one tissue. What is it? I can use another one tissue to close the hole. That is falciforum ligament. I can use the falciforum ligament also can be used instead of omental patch. I can use falciforum ligament also can be used. So I can use the falciforum ligament to close the perforation. So please don't forget modified Graham's patch closure. And most of the time we will only come out with these procedures. Very rarely, if the patient is stable, if it is an early case of perforation, if it is an early case with less contamination seen in the abdomen, what can I do along with these procedures? If there is less contamination in the peritoneum, patient is stable and I have taken a early case, I can go for a truncal vagotomy with GJ also will be done. It is not always done, only for these cases, only for stable patients, early case, less contamination, I will do this procedure. Early case, stable case, less contamination, I can also do TVGJ for those cases. Along with omental patch closure, omental patch, I will do this procedure. So this is just for completion. And coming to the perforated gastric ulcer. So please don't forget, what is perforated gastric ulcer management? I am discussing you the duodenal ulcer. Perforated gastric ulcer management is very simple, straightforward. Same, if patient is stable, what I will do? If patient is unstable, what I will do? If patient is unstable, just I will do omental patch closure, that's all. Just I will take a omental patch and keep it over it and close it. Omental patch closure plus biopsy from ulcer will be done. I will take biopsy from the ulcer and I will keep a omental patch and close it. So I will keep a omental patch and do a biopsy from the ulcer. So omental patch with the biopsy from the ulcer will be done for unstable patients. Stable patients, as we discussed already, whenever the patient is stable, we should go for a distal gastrectomy plus Billroth 2 will be done. Whenever the patient is stable, I will go for distal gastrectomy and Billroth 2 operation will be done by me. So whenever the patient is stable, I will go for this operation. This is for perforated gastric ulcers. So we have discussed bleeding, we have discussed perforation. So the last complication, which is nowadays very, very, very rare, and we are not seeing those type of complication, that is gastric outlet obstruction. I have not seen a case of gastric outlet obstruction for the past 1 year. In the past 5 years of my practice, only 3 cases I have seen gastric outlet obstruction. That much the incidence has fallen down. So in today's era, the most common cause of GOO in the era of PPI, it is cancer stomach. We are not at all seeing GOO nowadays due to peptic ulcer. If at all we are seeing, it is only a cancer stomach. So gastric outlet obstruction due to peptic ulcer is due to long-standing duodenal ulcer. Please remember, a long-standing duodenal ulcers. Long-standing duodenal ulcer will go for cicatrization. Will go for cicatrization and cause GOO. Will cause cicatrization and it will cause GOO. Long-standing duodenal ulcers will cause cicatrization and it will cause GOO. That is because of the long-standing duodenal ulcer. So this complication is very, very rare nowadays. But anyhow, we have to discuss it because of MCQ. Clinical features are: patient comes to you with a projectile vomiting of undigested food. Projectile vomiting of undigested food particles. Even 2-3 days back, he had that food particles will be coming out. Undigested food particles. So projectile vomiting of undigested food particles will be there. And when you see, he will have visible gastric peristalsis will be present. When you examine his abdomen, there will be left to right peristalsis. It is a left to right peristalsis seen. There will be left to right peristalsis seen in these patients. So projectile vomiting of undigested food particles, there will be visible gastric peristalsis from left to right peristalsis will be seen. Patient will have left to right peristalsis. And because of constant vomiting, they will have severe electrolyte imbalance. So please understand the electrolyte imbalance. Very important question for your exams. So let me give a simple mechanism actually what happens. So the patient is vomiting. So patient is vomiting, what he is going to vomit? He is going to vomit HCl, hydrochloric acid in the stomach is going to be vomited. So the patient will have decreased chloride level in his serum with metabolic alkalosis will happen. So please remember, the patient will develop a metabolic alkalosis and hypochloremia due to vomiting. And as a compensation to this, the convoluted tubules, the renal convoluted tubules are going to observe the bicarbonate back. They are going to observe the bicarbonate back into the circulation. They are going to observe bicarbonate back into the circulation. When they are going to observe bicarbonate, they should excrete one anion for sodium bicarbonate channel. You will be reading that. They will excrete sodium into the urine. So therefore, they will start developing hyponatremia. Initially, there will be hyponatremia because of bicarbonate excess. Exchange sodium will be going inside. So as bicarbonate is coming inside the body as a compensation for metabolic alkalosis, sodium will go down. After some time, the potassium will start going down. So potassium cannot be lost much because potassium is an essential organ for cardiac activity. So our body will automatically, the renin angiotensin system will automatically stop excreting potassium also. Initially, there will be hyponatremia, hypokalemia, and instead of potassium, there will be calcium start excreting out. That will result in hypocalcemia also. But at one stage of time, what happens? There is no enough anion in your body, and instead of sodium, instead of potassium, instead of calcium, H plus will be secreted in the urine. So you all know this is a case of metabolic alkalosis. In a metabolic alkalosis, if acid is secreted in the urine, it is going to aggravate the alkalosis. No, that is why we call this as paradoxical aciduria. Paradoxical renal aciduria. So please don't forget, this is a very simple mechanism. The patient is vomiting HCl, so he develops metabolic alkalosis and hypochloremia immediately. As a compensation for metabolic alkalosis, bicarbonate is absorbed back into the body. In exchange with sodium will be excreted. Sodium will be excreted, potassium will be excreted, calcium will be excreted, and finally acid itself will be excreted. Therefore, it is known as paradoxical renal aciduria. So for your exam, so please don't forget, it is a case of hypochloremic, hyponatremic, hypokalemic, hypocalcemic, metabolic, alkalosis. Very extreme cases may also have paradoxical aciduria can develop. This is a classical feature of electrolyte imbalance. So the moment you see these patients, immediately you should correct them by giving IV fluid of choice is normal saline. Please don't forget this. So normal saline is the fluid of choice. Ringer lactate should not be given. Ringer lactate may exacerbate the acidosis. Aciduria can be exacerbated due to the lactic acid component. The aciduria can be exacerbated. So Ringer lactate is contraindicated. So now you can ask, sir, there is hypokalemia. How will I correct the hypokalemia? Don't worry. Along with the normal saline, you give them KCL injection also. That is enough. That is a fluid of choice. So fluid of choice is normal saline with the injection KCL. Injection KCL will be given. So normal saline with injection KCL is a treatment of choice for this cases of electrolyte imbalance. And I should do stomach wash. I should put a Ryle's tube or a wide bore gastric lavage. Do a stomach wash. And then I will send the patient for investigation of choice. That is upper GI endoscopy is the investigation of choice. I cannot send the patient immediately for endoscopy. Please remember, I cannot send them immediately go for endoscopy and come. It is impossible. We have to put a wide bore lavage tube, wash everything in the stomach for 1 or 2 days. After that only we will send for endoscopy to find out the cause. To find the cause. There is a classical investigation of choice. In case of chronic duodenal ulcer with cicatrization, olden days we used to do barium meal. Barium meal will show you this finding in those days. What is this finding? Can you tell me? In duodenum, this finding is seen. This finding is seen in the duodenum first part. It looks like what deformity? Chronic duodenal ulcers will have this deformity known as trifoliate deformity. So nowadays nobody is doing barium meal at all in practice. Totally we are not doing barium meal. Totally the barium meal is replaced by endoscopy. Nobody does endoscopy barium meal for stomach and duodenal problems. Everyone immediately we put an endoscopy. So olden days this finding was there. Trifoliate deformity is a finding of deformed duodenal bulb. It is a finding of deformed duodenal bulb. Please don't forget this point. This is trifoliate deformity, barium meal finding. Please don't forget this finding. This is a finding of barium meal. And the moment I diagnose, the treatment of choice after the patient being resuscitated is, I will go for truncal vagotomy with the GJ. I'm telling you, for the past 5 years, I have not done a truncal vagotomy with GJ. Even patients with this type of GOO, they responded excellently with the PPI and most of them recovered. So treatment of choice, if they ask you, you can go for truncal vagotomy with GJ. Our medical gastro guys are also doing, MGE people, medical gastro guys are also doing endoscopic balloon dilatation of the duodenal ulcer. Endoscopic balloon dilatation is also done for this type of chronic duodenal ulcers. This is a point I want to tell you here. This is also done for these cases. Endoscopy, you can keep it there and we can dilate the cicatrized duodenum so that it will open up and we can give PPA and slowly that ulcer will heal. This is a classical treatment of chronic duodenal ulcer going for cicatrization. Chronic gastric ulcer going for cicatrization. It is totally not at all seen in the practice. Only for MCQ, a long-standing gastric ulcer can produce this deformity. This is known as Haarglass deformity. Or a chronic gastric ulcer can produce this deformity known as teapot deformity. These are all no more seen. These are all only for MCQ. That's all. Teapot deformity, Haarglass deformity are all various findings of chronic gastric ulcer. These are all gastric ulcers of your father days or your grandfather days. Nowhere we are seeing this type of cases. If at all, if it is seen, the treatment is we have to go for distal gastrectomy for these patients. For these patients, we have to go for distal gastrectomy with Billroth 2 reconstruction will be done for all these patients. So all these patients, we have to go for distal gastrectomy with Billroth 2. So now let me compile the complications we discussed. Complications and management I will discuss in a simpler way. All the complications and management. Complications of duodenal ulcer, complications of gastric ulcer. What are the complications? Intractable is one complication, number one. Number two, bleeding we discussed. I am going to tell only the surgical management. Perforation I discussed. Number 4, GOO, I discussed. You are going to tell the answer for each. Intractable duodenal ulcer, the treatment is what? High selective vagotomy is better than truncal vagotomy plus GJ according to Sabiston. Intractable gastric ulcer type 1, I told you wedge resection. Type 2 and 3, I told you we have to go for, what are the treatment for type 2 and 3? Type 2 and 3, we have to go for distal gastrectomy plus truncal vagotomy plus Billroth 2. Type 4 ulcers, we should go for Pouchet procedure, Kelling-Madliner procedure and Sendi's procedure. This is what I told you for intractable gastric ulcers. Bleeding duodenal ulcer, I told you 3-point U suture plus truncal vagotomy for stable patients. Plus truncal vagotomy for stable patients. Gastric ulcer, a bleeding patient, I will do oversewing of ulcer. Oversew the ulcer bleeding vessel. If patient is stable, I will go for distal gastrectomy. So patients are stable, I will go for distal gastrectomy. Perforation, I told you, modified Graham's patch is commonly used. Modified Graham's patch closure is used for perforation. For perforation, we use a modified Graham's patch closure. In gastric ulcer, I told you, we have to go for unstable patients, omental patch, stable patients, distal gastrectomy. GOO, duodenal ulcer patients, I should go for truncal vagotomy with GJ. Gastric ulcer patients, I should go for distal gastrectomy plus Billroth 2 reconstruction. Distal gastrectomy plus Billroth 2 reconstruction done for gastric ulcer patients. So this is the compilation of all the complications we discussed together. This is a compilation of all the complications we discussed together. I hope you are understanding this theory. So all these are various points of peptic ulcer disease. If you have any doubt in peptic ulcer disease, please tell me. These are the various issues I want you to remember. The complications of peptic ulcer disease. Okay. Thank you.